The hyper-evolution of humanity. The human race is not immune from evolution. You could be forgiven for thinking otherwise due to our species' increasing reliance on technology. But despite the presence of labor-saving devices, mass transportation, and on-demand erotica, evolution continues to exert its influence on Homo sapiens today. And what's more is that evolution could be occurring faster than ever before, with the human race currently undergoing a period of hyper-evolution like nothing we've ever seen before. Modern evolution. In 2015, a study published in Nature Genetics revealed that all modern humans can trace their ancestry back to a common male ancestor, a genetic Adam who existed 250,000 years ago. This discovery means that humans are genetically diverging faster than we previously thought, and that the evolution of our species is progressing more rapidly than at any point in human history. This may not seem the case if you've ever watched an episode of Here Comes Honey Boo Boo, but we assure you it's true. Evidence of contemporary evolution was published earlier this year in the paper Signatures of Negative Selection in the Genetic Architecture of Human Complex Traits, which exposed a number of recent gene alterations. Using genomic information taken from 126,545 participants in the UK's Biobank project, 28 traits were identified and investigated by a team of University of Queensland researchers in an attempt to study how the genes linked to these attributes changed between generations. Body fat percentage, male pattern baldness, and type 2 diabetes were just some of the traits investigated, with others including hand grip strength, educational attainment, and neuroticism scores also tracked. Now that last one seems a bit of a mistake to me. If romantic comedies have taught me anything, it's that British dudes are super neurotic. This study may as well have investigated the peacefulness of Canadians, or the propensity for Welsh people to invent words that are deliberately too difficult to say. I mean, look at the state of yourself, Wales. This is not okay. I digress. Upon the conclusion of this study, researchers found that characteristics which improve your survival chances are still being favored today, with natural selection also causing non-favorable attributes to be continuously discarded. Traits related to fertility and cardiovascular health were the most influenced by natural selection, and this should be no surprise given our generation's love of casual hookups and hot pockets, sometimes both at once if I'm, feeling lavish. Those who are genetically predisposed to having more fat around their waist were seen to be less likely to pass this on to their children, with this trait known to increase your chances of developing heart disease and type 2 diabetes. Likewise, the age at which women develop the menopause was also heavily influenced by natural selection, with evolution favoring a later onset to increase a woman's lifetime fertility. These developments may seem minor on their own, but when you look back at the history of recent human evolution, they serve to paint a picture of a species whose genetic future is very much guided by its own well-developed hand. Evolution by necessity. The next time a creationist tries to convince you that evolution is a myth, just drag them up to the top of a Tibetan mountain and force them to watch while a white Estonian person eats a whole block of cheese without throwing up. If they know anything about the genetic history of human beings, they should be instantly convinced. Do we need to explain why? Oh, all right then. For a start, the low oxygen levels at the top of a mountain should make regular humans pass out and die. But studies of the Tibetan people have revealed that their blood is able to create a higher number of oxygen-transporting hemoglobins than any other group. This ability is present in the genes of Tibetans due to their historic inhabitants of high-altitude landscapes like the Himalayas. And geneticists believe the mutations which enabled this may have taken place within the past few thousand years. Next up, the reason for the white Estonian. Blue-eyed people are the most commonly found in northeastern Europe and Scandinavia, and this trait is also the result of a recent genetic divergence, with scientists believing that baby blues are the result of a mutation in a single genetic ancestor who lived 6,000 to 10,000 years ago. As for the white skin, well, that only developed when humans left Africa. Until about 10,000 years ago, Europeans and Africans were similarly pigmented. Racism was basically impossible back then, just like Kanye believes it is now. White skin absorbs vitamin D more efficiently than darker skin, and this trait was essential for humans living in colder, northern climates with less exposure to the sun. And finally, we come to the cheese. Did you know that once an animal has finished being breastfed, it loses the ability to process milk sugars? This is true of all animals and the majority of humans, with 3/4 of the world being lactose intolerant. Many of these milk haters still consume dairy. They just lack the enzymes necessary to digest it, leading to the unfortunate expulsion of said items in the form of a backdoor liquid explosion. However, those who are blessed by the Dairy Queen and who are able to enjoy the fruitful bounty of bovine bosoms do so due to a genetic mutation which appeared in Hungarians 7,500 years ago. The consumption of high-calorie dairy items helped early Europeans survive the incredibly harsh winters which prevailed at the time, and this explains why some adults can still drink milk today, and also how vegans would have gone extinct if they'd lived in prehistoric Europe. One of the most shocking evolutionary developments in recent human history has been the gradual shrinking of the human brain, which itself follows many millions of years of consistent brain growth. As yet, we have no evidence as to what is causing human brains to shrink, but one theory suggests it may have something to do with our peaceful and organized modern existence. And this is just one example of how our societal and technological development is helping to guide, rather than prevent, the path of human evolution. Controlled evolution. Cro-Magnon humans existed in Europe between 20,000 and 30,000 years ago, and they may have possessed the largest brains of any humans, past, present, or future. Until Cro-Magnon came along, our brains had been growing continuously since our emergence as an intelligent species. But between 20 and 30 millennia ago, things changed course, and modern human gray matter has shrunk by 10% compared to that of our big-brained ancestors. Whether this change is positive or negative, we cannot yet say. Brain shrinkage has been noted within domesticated animals such as cats and dogs, and one theory suggests the domestication of humanity has affected us in a similar way. Cognitive scientist David Geary believes that as our society becomes ever more safe, humans require less intelligence and strength in order to survive and reproduce. This seems to ring true. How many immediate threats to your existence do you experience on a daily basis? I mean, sure, you might get run over by a car or choked to death on a particularly stupid Lena Dunham tweet, but neither of these things are predators which we need to evolve to defend against. So, with most of our species' needs and threats taken care of, is it possible a reliance on technology and society may eventually cause humans to de-evolve? Devolution of a species is completely possible, with this paper demonstrating how a type of European lizard was seen to revert back to laying eggs, having previously evolved to give birth to live young. Some lizards began to spurt out live offspring 2 million years ago, which means that the rebel egg-laying lizards must have regained the ability to lay eggs quite recently, having reawakened this dormant trait within their DNA. Devolution is not, therefore, an inherently negative process. If losing a modern trait and regaining an old one helps a species to continue existing, how could this be seen as anything but a positive? In this sense, anthropologist Brian Hare believes that human brain shrinkage may too be a beneficial evolutionary trait, since it often indicates a lack of aggression and an increase in tolerance and cooperation. Our brains and bodies are adapting to our newfound comfortable existence, and as we gradually lose other archaic elements of our genetic makeup, perhaps this will also lead to a more harmonious future for mankind. One without war, murder, or Twitter. God damn, I hate Twitter. We may even end up healthier too, as evidence published in New Scientist seems to show that genes associated with Alzheimer's and heavy smoking are both dying off. The fate of the latter is incredibly profound. Since humans have only been smoking for around 8,000 years, with the practice becoming common just 2,000 years ago, In that short period of time, humans have already started to evolve into beings which are less likely to indulge in heavy smoking, while also beginning to naturally select against those with asthma, high blood pressure, and too much junk in their trunk. All of these ailments are related to harmful aspects of our modern society. And so it seems that as we create ever more ways to enjoy, thrill, and kill ourselves, evolution is there watching in the background, quietly weeding out those who take things a little too far. But what happens when humanity gains full control of evolution on a genetic level? Is this even possible? And if not, what else might guide our species' development in future? We're going to explore this in our bonus video, The Evolution of Spacefaring Humans, which you can watch on our Patreon page at patreon.com/strangemysteries. For a $2 a month pledge, which you can cancel at any time, you'll get to watch this and all of our bonus content, which goes deeper and darker into every topic than YouTube allows. If you don't want to donate, then that's bullshit.
We know you wanted more. Strange Mysteries on YouTube and our Patreon bonus videos weren't enough to quench your search for truth, to give you that sense of awe and wonder again, to go past what you thought was the end, to give you the answers you seek, but which only lead to more questions. That's why we just upped the stakes. Chemicals of reality. Reality, consciousness, brains. What else is there? Ask yourself that question. Perhaps that's all there really is, but perhaps everything else is found within a place where these ideas, these things, overlap. Some thing, some place that is undefinable. To many people, altering certain chemicals in their brains produces what they would simply call hallucinations. In fact, what we're going to discuss specifically used to be called the businessman's trip, as one could enjoy it. Come down and put your pants back on in the time it takes to eat lunch. It wasn't taken seriously. Well, unless, of course, you started digging. And some people, including us, did. Already, though, to many people, this chemical is special amongst others. Very special. To them, it represents something more meaningful and incredible, as if it's the gateway to the next level of consciousness. The ticket to a higher reality barely explored by most humans. It is the entry point to a new reality visited by only a select few whose minds have become enlightened through the use of this exotic substance. For this reason, it's commonly referred to as the spirit molecule. But is its reputation as a mystical mind opener deserved? Or is it and everything it represents just a load of bullshit? We look at, investigate, and dive deeply into nearly all available research regarding this question from nearly every angle feasible. And in the course of doing so, stumble upon unexplainable patterns, correlations, and neurological evidence for a reality existing beyond this one. Watch this hour-long Strange Mysteries premium video, Chemicals of Reality, as well as many more to come by becoming an elite premium member of our Patreon at patreon.com/strangemysteries.